Good morning, everyone. Welcome to worship. I'm so glad you all are here. I want to ask that you all stand with me this morning. And before we get started, let's just take a moment to pray. Dear God, I just want to thank you for everyone who's here this morning. I'm so glad we get this time to just be together and worship you. And this morning, I just want to pray that as we lift our hearts to you, that you might fill them with new love. I want to pray that as we lift our minds to you, that you would pour fresh hope into our thinking, as we lift our souls, that they might bathe in your grace, and as we lift our hands and our voices to sing your praises, as we come to worship and adore you, our Lord God, as we offer our whole being into worship this morning.
All the thieves will come confess. may be seated. From Exodus chapter 13, we get the story or the account, part of the account, of the Exodus out of Egypt and what that meant for the nation of Israel. And in Exodus chapter 13, beginning in verse 17, it says, "When Pharaoh let the people go, God did not lead them on the road through the Philistine country, though that was shorter. For God said if they face war, they might change their minds and return to Egypt. So God led the people around by the desert road toward the Red Sea. The Israelites went up out of Egypt ready for battle. Moses took the bones of Joseph with him because Joseph had made the Israelites swear an oath. He had said, 'God will surely come to your aid, and then you must carry my bones up with you from this place.' And after leaving Succoth, they camped at Etham on the edge of the desert. By day, the Lord went ahead of them in a pillar of cloud to guide them on their way, and by night in a pillar of fire to give them light, so that they could travel by day or night. Neither the pillar of cloud by day nor the pillar of fire by night left its place in front of the people." And from Jeremiah chapter 32, starting in verse 36, we again read of God's ever-presence, the fact that he does not abandon his people. And in verse 36, it says, "You are saying about this city, 'By the sword, famine, and plague, it will be given into the hands of the king of Babylon.' But this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says, 'I will surely gather them from their lands, from all the lands where I banished them in my furious anger and great wrath. I will bring them back to this place and let them live in safety. They will be my people and I will be their God. I will give them singleness of heart and action so that they will always fear me, and that all will then go well for them and for their children after them. I will make an everlasting covenant with them. I will never stop doing good to them, and I will inspire them to fear me so that they will never turn away from me. I will rejoice in doing them good, and will assuredly plant them in this land with all my heart and my soul." One of the things that we are asked to do, or one of the things that I ask you to do when we read Scripture, is that we ask the question, what does this say about Jesus? And what does the Exodus, this presence of God leading the people, say about Jesus? What does this account in Jeremiah, as God talks about his great wrath, but gathering the people back, giving them signs so that they might fear him and his promise to never depart them? What does this say about Jesus? All of this Old Testament points to what God does amongst his people. When we believe in Jesus, he gathers us out of the wild places. He brings us back in. He welcomes us home. This word fear isn't meant to be so much in terror and foreboding, but instead in love and in reverence of God. "That they will love me, they will revere me," is what God says. "I will bring them back in. Because of Jesus, I welcome my people home. And my presence goes before them and amongst them." This is the promise that God is making us in these moments. We're going to be starting a new series today called Out of the Desert. We're going to be looking at what God does for Israel as he brings them out of the desert and into the promised land. But more importantly, what that says for us. How does the story of Israel leaving the desert of wandering tell us about what God is doing in our lives today? One of the first things we're going to do today, though, is we're going to gather around the table. This is one of the places where God brings us out of the desert. He invites us to come to his table. And you don't invite people to come to the table that you don't want there. You don't invite people to a banquet, to a feast, when you don't like them, when you don't want them to be part of what you're sharing. And especially when we come to this feast and we share in God's true presence, as Christ comes to us in the bread and in the wine, he shares not just the food, not just sustenance for life, but he shares himself, sustenance for our spirit. As Christ promises to always be with us. In the desert wandering, God led the people. It's a cloud of smoke during the day, as a pillar of fire at night. He led them. He was among them. But for us, God plants His Holy Spirit in us, that He dwells not just among us, but within us. And so as we eat and drink, once again, we take God's presence in with us as He fills us and sustains us and nourishes us through his body and by His blood. So our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night in which He was betrayed, He took bread and He broke it. And He gave it to His disciples to eat, saying, "Take and eat, this is My body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of Me." And again, after supper, He took the cup, and after He had blessed it, He gave it to them to drink, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in My blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of Me." Isn't that good news? This cup is the new covenant in My blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of what? Your sins. How many of them? All of them. And so you are invited this morning to come partake in this, the bread and the wine, the true presence of Christ. Come, the Lord's table is ready. And now may what you have received, the true body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve you to everlasting life. Amen. Will you pray with me this morning? Gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we just come this morning and we give thanks. We thank you, Lord, for all that you have poured into us, your true presence in the bread and the wine, Lord. You have filled us this morning. You have seen our repentant hearts, Lord, and you have worked your forgiveness in our lives, washing us clean once again by the blood of your Son. And so we are grateful, Lord, for how you work and how you sustain us and how you save us, Lord, even from ourselves. And so this morning, as we're gathered here today, Lord, let us have grateful hearts. Let us be gathered together with joy and thanksgiving, Lord, as we acknowledge your goodness and your presence among us and in our lives. Lord, we also thank you for the way that you answer prayers. We thank you, Lord, for what you, for the way that you hear when we have need and we have challenges, and you, Lord, you answer those. Lord, we give thanks for Paul White as he's had successful surgery, Lord, and as he has his post-op appointment this week, Lord. We just pray that you would bring restoration of his healing. We thank you, Lord, for how you have worked in his life, Lord, and we pray, Lord, that you would bring him back to full health. We give thanks this morning, Lord, we thank you this morning for Chuck and Sylvia as they've joined us in worship today, and they're celebrating their 45th anniversary today, Lord. We thank you for the life that they have spent together, Lord, that you have put together, and we pray, Lord, for many more years for them. We lift up to you, Lord, those who have need as well. We recognize that, Lord, there are always things that we need to pray for. There are always those who are having struggles and challenges. We lift up to you Bert, Lord, who's having quadruple bypass surgery tomorrow. Lord, we pray for your hand of peace and calm on him. We pray for the skill of the surgeons, Lord. We pray that he would come through this surgery successfully. We lift up to you Elena and her chronic health issues, Lord, and just issues with anxiety and stress, Lord. We pray that you would bring her healing. And we pray, Lord, for peace in her life as she continues to struggle with anxiety, Lord. And we just pray that you would be with her in this time as well. Lord, as we're pushing towards the end of summer, in just over a week, Lord, many of our children, grandchildren, will be going back to school. Lord, we pray for this start of this school year. We lift up to you the teachers and all of the staff in the schools, all of the students, and we pray, Lord, this would be an amazing year for them. Lord, we know all the challenges that face children in schools, social pressure, peer pressure, academic pressure, and Lord, just battling with life and the challenges with growing up. Lord, we pray that you would be, your hand of blessing would be upon our students wherever they are, whether they are in elementary school or middle or high school or off at college. Lord, just may your hand of protection be upon them. And Lord, for all of our teachers who give so much and work so hard to shape and mold our students, Lord, we We pray for strength for them. Lord, for all the other needs that we have in our lives, for the hurts that we experience, for the challenges that we endure, Lord, for the brokenness we see in our world. We lift all of these things up to you, praying and placing them into your hands and praying all these things in the name of the one who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. This time I announce our offering. The offerings that we take go to support the ministries of Christ Community as we, the people who call Christ Community our home, give back to the work that God has called us to in this place. You know this by now. It's up on the screen, all the ways you can give. Red offering boxes at the entry, out at the welcome table, through the P.O. box, online at ccridgefield.com, or in the Christ Community Church app. But what I invite you to do this morning as we move through the worship is just take time to reflect on how God has blessed you in your life, all that he has given you, and how he's calling you to give back out of those rich blessings. A couple of announcements to make this morning. Believe it or not, we've got stuff going on that's coming up here. Just things having to do with church and things that are coming up. I didn't write them down, Elena, but I have them on slides. So if you could give me the next one. That was the cool one to announce the announcements. But then this one. Okay, Experience Ridgefield. We mentioned this last week. That's coming up here on Saturday, September 10. This is a chance for Christ Community to be in our community, to reach out and connect with the people of our community, to let them know that we're here in this community. It's a cool opportunity for families and kids. Put on by the school district. We have a couple of more slots to fill. Thank you to everybody who signed up last week. We just have a couple of more. If you would like to come out and help for a 2.5-hour shift on Saturday, September 10, we'll be downtown Ridgefield, right across from the Nazarene Church on the big field at the RAC, the Ridgefield Administrative and Civic Center. Yeah, got that right. That's different than the RORC, which is the Ridgefield Outdoor Recreation Complex. Okay, so you got to get that RAC versus RORC. That's downtown. Sign up. That's out on the welcome table. You can get signed up for that out there if you can help us out with that. We just have a couple more slots to fill. That would be great. Second one, we're looking for a couple of people to be greeters on Sunday morning. We want this to be a welcoming place as people are going back to school. God willing, we're going to start seeing some more foot traffic too. We want people to know they are welcome here. So if you could help us out on a rotating basis, this doesn't have to be every week. We would like to have a greeter out at the door out there. We'd like to have a couple of people who are just willing to make this you guys do a great job, by the way, letting people know that they're welcome here. But we'd like to have a couple of people do that. If you would be willing to sign up to help a couple of Sundays a month be a greeter, come let me know. That would be great. Next one. Sunday morning cookies and flowers. Marge, this one's for you. Put that up there just for you. Marge is in charge of this, so she reminds me periodically. Let people know. We have sign-up sheets out there to sign up to bring flowers for the altar, to bring cookies for Sunday morning. If you can help with that, sign-up sheet is out there in the lobby. Elena, did I have any others? Is that it? That was it. Okay, great. So now you are all up to date. What I'd like to do is invite you to stand up, take just a minute or two to greet someone that you did not ride in the car with this morning. Hi, good morning, everyone. Welcome to church. We are starting a new series this morning titled Out of the Desert. And to begin today, I want to begin with an observation. As we get into this, and I'll explain what we're talking about a little more in depth as we go along, but I want to start with an observation. Maybe you already know this, but have you ever noticed how two people can look at the same thing but see something completely different? Right? You know, they're looking at exactly the same thing, but what they see isn't the same. It's like looking at a picture together, one of those kind of abstract pictures, and one person sees two people kissing, and the other one sees two elephants on circus balls. right? And you're trying to figure out how the other person sees what they're seeing, right? Or one person sees ocean waves and the other one sees the bottom of a car door. One place this really became visible was with a viral image on social media back in 2017. Actually, there was a precursor to it. I don't know if any of you remember or heard about the dress, but it was this thing I put up on social media, and people looked at it, and some people saw the dress was blue and black, and other people saw that it was white and gold, and there were like competitions, you know, about this, and people inside their families were arguing over whether it was blue and black or white and gold. In 2017, there was a follow-up to the dress, and in the dynamic naming of the internet, they called it the dress. This one was called the shoe. Don't put it up yet. Just leave it there. I've got a picture. I don't want it up there yet because I want to explain what we're doing. Okay? The same question, though, arose. I'm going to put the challenge before you this morning. I'm going to have Elena in just a second put the shoe up there, and then we're going to decide what you see. You ready? All right, Elena, why don't you put that picture up? There it is, was the shoe, okay? Now, some people say that the shoe is white and pink. Other people say that it is gray and teal. So we are going to take a professional poll this morning, and we're going to see what people see when they look at this, all right? How many of you see the shoe as white and pink? Raise your hand, all right? How many of you see the shoe as gray and teal and love Jesus? Raise your hand. All right, okay, so let's do that again. White and pink, okay, gray and teal. Take a look around the room. We're split almost 50-50 between what we see. Would it shock you to know that this shoe is actually white and pink? For those of you who see gray and teal, that is not the color of the shoe. But the funny thing about this, is when you look at it, I've looked at this and I've looked at this. Jennifer and I have talked about this. I cannot make myself see it any other way. I cannot see the white and the pink. But the interesting thing is in this room, this isn't a trick. It's a trick of lighting, yeah? But we have about 50-50 raise their hands and see white and pink versus teal and green. And the funny thing about this is it can become divisive. You know, the dress was divisive. I mean, it's silly arguing about the color of a shoe. You know, and Jennifer and I were talking about this last night. She saw pink and white, and I saw gray and teal, and she's asking me at one point, how can you see that? It's wrong. And I, of course, responded with class and character, and I told her she was crazy because it was gray and teal. And then I told her she was supposed to defer to me because I was the man, and she sent me to my room. But what the shoe illustrates, not only because we can look at the same image and see something completely differently, but also because of how we argue with one another over what we see, because what I see must be the way that it is. And sometimes we're in situations where we try really hard, but we can't see what the other person sees. And if you see it different, you must be wrong. And there's a word for this, and it's called perspective. That your perspective shapes what you look at, and it determines what you see. I am not flashing lights back and forth up there and somehow putting up two images where you only see one so that some of you see gray and teal and some of you see white and pink. It's the same shoe. But our perspective shapes what we see. Okay, so the lighting in that, our brains are making conscious adjustments or unconscious adjustments that cause the input from our eyes to be interpreted differently. Ivan Schwab is a medical doctor. He's the clinical spokesman for the American Academy of Ophthalmology, and he says the best consideration is contextual, that's perspective. meaning the context in which you see it. Lighting, background, what's associated. So what's happening is that your brain is making hundreds of assumptions about what your eyes are feeding to it, and your perceptions fuel how your brain interprets the image. In our everyday lives, we do the same thing. We see things, we read things, we interpret them based on our perceptions, on our perspectives, what we know, what we believe, our prejudices, and our ideals. All of this fuels our understanding. So the question isn't, what are you looking at? It's, what's your perspective? What is your perspective? I can look at the same news headline as a friend and see a tragedy, and they can see a victory. I can look at an election and be jubilant while my neighbor is angry. Some people see the strength of the market and see a strong economy. Others see the exact same number and they see an unequal wealth gap. Your perspective fuels your understanding. One person wonders why her boyfriend would want a neighbor with his mistress, and another person is saying, you're the mistress. Perspective shapes what we look at, and it determines what we see. In the Gospels, Jesus would often look at something and see it completely different than his disciples. At the feeding of the 5,000, the disciples, they see a boy's lunch, and all they can think of is, it isn't enough. There's not enough. There's too many people. There's too little food. Jesus, on the other hand, sees the opportunity to feed thousands. At the death of Lazarus, the mourners see death, an end. They're mourning the loss of a friend. At the exact same tomb, Jesus sees life. We see a world rapidly going to hell. Jesus sees people worth saving and a world worth redeeming. When you look around you, what do you see? Are you looking through the lens of what God can do? Or through the lens of despair and hopelessness? In this series, we're going to look at the life of Joshua, at least part of it, and his involvement with Israel as they're led out of the desert and into the land of promise. And today is all about perspective. And it's called overwhelming opposition because Joshua and his buddy Caleb are given a task along with 10 other men to go into the land of Canaan, bring back a report about what they see. And in Numbers chapter 13 and 14, what we read is that two of the men end up facing off against the other 10 and eventually the entire population of Israel. They face overwhelming opposition because their perspective is different. Now, a little background. For 400 years, Israel was enslaved in Egypt. They went down there under Joseph. Things were good for a while, but as time passed, new pharaohs rose, and the memory of Joseph and his interaction with Israel, his connection to Pharaoh, disappeared, and new pharaohs came on the scene, and they were afraid of the Israelites, and they enslaved them. You know, they made them work. They seriously curtailed where they could go and what they could do. But now God has rescued them from 400 years of slavery, and the people of Israel have seen God's power firsthand as he poured out plague after plague on their captors. And they're led out of Egypt under Moses. And from our reading this morning, right, we remember the Red Sea mentioned that. God led them around to the shore of the Red Sea. And if you grew up in Sunday school at all, you know the story, right? Moses walked up to the edge, and at God's direction, he planted his staff, the water at the edge of the Red Sea, and what happened? I remember the flannel gram, right? Right? The water, just that flannel thing of the water pushed back, and you know, the person in Sunday school could actually take, it was cool. I don't know if you ever had one like this, but they could take the part of the water off, and they could replace it with this curled back wave thing. That was neat, right? And so this is what happened, and so the power of God again was displayed right before them. Say, all they had to do was follow God's direction and walk. And they were on dry land. And when they got through, the waters came crashing down and obliterated Pharaoh's army, securing Israel's freedom. And the message that Moses gives them is, God will fight for you. And now, after a journey in the desert and the handing down of the law, they stand on the edge of the land of Canaan, the land that God has promised to give them, the land that he's been promising since the time of Abraham. Generation after generation have heard God's promise, and now they stand on the cusp of fulfillment. And in Numbers chapter 13 and verse 1, it says, "The Lord said to Moses, 'Send some men to explore the land of Canaan, which I'm giving to the Israelites. From each ancestral tribe, send one of its leaders.'" So God says, "I'm giving you this land. I'm giving it to you. This is the promised land. This isn't the maybe land, right? This isn't the land of, this isn't the, you know, possibly this could be it land, right? It isn't the land of if. God doesn't say, "Hey, look, I've got several lands in mind. It might be one of them. This could be in the top five." No, he says, "This is the land that I'm giving you." And God says, "Get together some men, one from each tribe. Send them in and take a look at it, because this is the place." And they aren't sent to decide if the land's okay. That wasn't the mission of the spies. They weren't sent in so that they could have a conference with God when they got back, give their input, God could decide. He'd already decided. Right? He's already made it. And what we need to hear from this is that we also need to not let our feelings about what's possible get in the way of what God has already determined. How often do we do that? God is telling them it is already decided. There are so many places in our lives where God is calling and giving us direction and saying, "You know what? I have a plan for you." And we're sitting there going, "You know what? I want to dip my toe in the water and just see if it's cold first. I'm not so sure." How often do we look at the land that God has promised and we decide it isn't possible? And what we're seeing here is, don't let your perception determine what God has already chosen. Moses sends the spies in and he says, "Hey, check it out. See what the people are like. Check out the quality of land. Bring back some fruit." And Moses is telling them, he says, "Determine if the people are good or bad. You know, we need to know what's there. Few or numerous, strong or weak, go and see, but also look for fruit." I love his direction to look for fruit, because fruit is always synonymous with good, right? You want, in life, when you're looking for fruit, when God tells you to bear fruit, he's talking about bearing good things. When he sends them into the promised land to look for fruit, they're to look for what's good in the land. Go and look for the good, Moses says, at God's direction. And so they go. They go into the land, and in verse 25, it says, at the end of the 40 days, they returned from exploring the land. They came back to Moses and Aaron and the entire Israelite community. I can't imagine what it must have been like. I mean, the Israelite community has just escaped from Egypt. They've been enslaved for 400 years. Their parents and their parents' parents and their parents' parents' parents and their parents' parents' parents. I'm not quite sure how many generations back at that point 400 years is. But they had been enslaved for 400 years. And now, all of a sudden, over a whirlwind course of time, they've been released. They've seen God's power. They've gone into the desert. God has interacted with them. He's been in the middle of them. He's given them his law. And they are now standing on the cusp of the fulfillment of a promise that was made hundreds and hundreds of years before. And so that 40 days must have been like agony for them as the 12 spies are wandering around in there and they're going, "What's coming? You know, what's next?" And so when they come back, the spies come back to Moses and Aaron and the entire Israelite community. And the spies give their report. And they see something different. In verse 27, it says, they gave Moses this account. "We went into the land to which you sent us, and it does flow with milk and honey. We found the fruit. But the people who live there are powerful, and the cities are fortified and very large. And we even saw descendants of Anak there, and the Amalekites are live in the Negev, and the Hittites, the Jebusites, and the Amorites, they're up in the hill country, and the Canaanites, they live by the sea and along the Jordan. We brought the fruit, but we're lucky to have escaped with our lives." And Caleb silenced the people before Moses, and he said, "We should go up and take possession of the land, for we can certainly do it." And in that moment, you see that 10 of the guys see the shoe as one color, and 2 of them see it differently. 10 of the spies said, "Yeah, it looks good, but it's occupied. There's people all over the place. They're strong. The cities are strong. They're all really scary." Caleb, on the other hand, speaks for himself and Joshua, and he says, "We should go." 12 go to look. And 10 see the bad, and 2 see the good, and the news spreads like a virus. spreads among the people, and the story grows with the telling. It says in verse 31, the men who had gone up with him said, "We can't attack those people." Okay, so here's one guy has spoken, and some of the men who had gone, they spoke up then, said, "We can't attack them. They're stronger than we are." And they spread among the Israelites a bad report about the land they had explored. And then they said, "The land we explored devours those living in it." Not sure where they got that, but now the story seems to be growing some. It's getting worse with the telling. "It devours those living in it, and all the people we saw are great size. They're big, they're giants. And we saw the Nephilim there, the descendants of Anak come from the Nephilim. And we seemed like grasshoppers in our own eye. And we looked the same to them." So he says, the land devours those living in it. And there's giants. And we're small and insignificant. And in verse 14, we see where this story goes. It says, "That night, all the members of the community raised their voices and they wept aloud. All the Israelites grumbled against Moses and Aaron, and the whole assembly said to them, 'If only we died in Egypt.'" Right? "Or in the wilderness. Man, if we died before this moment, that would have been better than this. Why is the Lord bringing us to the land only to let us fall by the sword?" I don't even know what God is up to. But whatever it is, it's bad. "Our wives and children will be taken of plunder. Wouldn't it be better for us to go back to Egypt?" I mean, slavery's got to be better than this. That's just funny because they're standing on the outside in the desert looking in. And that is worse than slavery. "And they said to each other, 'We should choose a leader and go back to Egypt.'" And the critical spirit of the ten becomes contagious and it spreads and people are weeping and they protest and they complain. "Why is the Lord bringing us here? He's out to get us. Let's choose a leader and get out of here," which is ironic because Moses and Aaron are already the leaders. So they're planning a mutiny or a coup or something. Joshua and Caleb, they try to shift the perspective because the people are now locked into the fact that the shoe is gray and teal. I know, for those of you who see it as gray and teal, I'm not saying you're negative in spirit. I had to pick one. And the shoe is actually white and pink. So for those of us who see gray and teal, we're wrong. Okay? They're locked into the fact that they're locked into what they see. And Caleb and Joshua, they're trying to shift the perspective. And Joshua says in verse 7, he says, "The land we passed through and explored is exceedingly good. This is a good place. If the Lord is pleased with us, he'll lead us into the land. A land flowing with milk and honey." Remember, the guy who got us out of Egypt, the guy who parted the Red Sea. If he's with us, he's going to lead us in, and there's good stuff there. It says, "Only do not rebel against the Lord, and do not be afraid of the people of the land, because we will devour them." We don't look like grasshoppers. They look like grasshoppers. Their protection is gone, but the Lord is with us. Do not be afraid. The land is good. The Lord's going to give it to us. But all the people can see is their fear and their despair. All they can see is overwhelming opposition. They can't see that God wants to lead them out of the desert and into a place of overflowing good. Instead, they turn on the two, and if you read further, they seek to stone them. They want to put Caleb and Joshua to death, right? Because they don't like the report. They don't like what Caleb's telling them to do, so the solution is to kill them. Same picture. Different reports. It's all perspective. They're all looking at the same thing. But the ten see through the lens of fear and inadequacy, while Joshua and Caleb see it through the lens of God. They remember what he's done, how he kept their promise, his promises. They're not afraid. Our perspective shapes what we look at. It determines what we see. And if we aren't seeing with God shaping our perspective, we're going to be like the ten and not like the two. So what I have here in the last few minutes are just three faith questions that should help shape your perspective and determine what you see if you use them, okay? And the first one is this. What are you looking for? What are you looking for? Because what you look for shapes your perspective. If you're always looking for fruit, guess what you're going to see? Yeah, any of you garden? Any of you go out searching your plants for the fruit? Yeah. Do you find it? Sometimes. But if you're looking for the good, you're going to see good things. But guess what? If you're always looking for problems, guess what you're going to find? You will have no problem finding problems if that's what you're looking for. It's amazing how often what you look for is exactly what you discover. If you're looking for good, you're going to find good. If you're looking for trouble, you're going to find trouble. Joshua and Caleb went into the promised land, and they're looking for the fruit. They knew God's promise to Abraham. They knew they were being sent at his direction. They believed that what they would find is what God had promised. And they found it. They came back and said, it overflows. Right? It's not just full of. It doesn't have enough of. It's overflowing with milk and honey. A land of abundant promise. Sure, they saw giants too. You know, you think they didn't see them? They saw the giants. They saw the cities and the numerous people. But they also didn't doubt God. The 10, though, went looking for trouble, and that's what they found. And in their minds, it was insurmountable. If you want to know your perspective, you need to ask yourself, are you looking for the fruit, or are you looking for the giants? Simon Sinek is an expert on leadership, and he tells a story about an experience he had with a friend in the park. And they had gone to the park for a run, and at the end of their run, they got to the end, and they're kind of cooling down, and Simon looks up, and he sees a table with a guy giving away free bagels. And he's like, hey, I just got done running. I'm hungry. I could really go for a bagel. And he pokes his buddy and he says, hey, let's go over and get a bagel. And the guy looks up and he says, yeah, but I don't want to stand in the line. Simon didn't even realize there was a line there. What he saw was the bagels. And he was like, I see the good. I see the fruit. I'm going for the bagel. But his buddy's like, yeah, I don't want to stand in the line. And Simon says he discovered in that moment that there are two possible ways of looking at the world. You either see the bagel or you see the line. Are you looking for what's possible, or are you looking for ways to prevent what's possible? The 10 spies do see the good. They bring back the fruit, but it's overshadowed by the problems. And the difference between them and Joshua and Caleb is fear versus faith. They look at the world, they see the world through the lens of fear. And this lens is close up, right? You see everything's big and overwhelming and scary. It seems like too much. The lens of faith, though, is a wide angle lens. You get perspective, you can see the bigger picture. You can see the line at the table, but you also can see the bagels. You know, you see the trouble, but you can see the good at the end. And a lot of us right now, we're looking at things through the close up lens. We live a lot of our life afraid or angry or frustrated. We see the world as hopeless. We're busy building walls to protect our little part of it. We're looking at the news and the politics and the courts and even our neighbors, and we don't see opportunity. We just hope it will end. We need a shift in perspective. So I have a challenge for you today. There were going to be a stack of composition notebooks by the door. I forgot to bring them up, but you guys can get a notebook. You can manage that. So here's my challenge. I want you to start a gratitude journal. Can you do that? Date your entry for each day and write down three things. Three, that says two, I know. But write down three things each day that you're grateful for. And on Sunday, I want you to add an extra line and write down one to two opportunities that God has given you. And see if that doesn't shift your perspective some. Because if you're constantly looking for what you're grateful for, if you're constantly looking for the opportunities that God puts before you, it's really hard to be focused on the problems. You know, maybe this is a chance to talk with your pro-choice neighbor. Not tell them how wrong they are to see gray and teal, but instead help them see pink and white. Maybe this is a chance to talk with the guy with the BLM sign in his yard and understand him a little bit. Look for the bagels. Skip the line. When you do this, things are going to change. I guarantee your perspective will change if you take the next 4 weeks of this series and you write down things you're grateful for. Because if you intentionally make that part of your life, you're going to start seeing things more great. Felicia Smith isn't here to correct me if I say gratefully. I think that's right. you're going to have a more grateful heart and spirit. Philippians chapter 4, Paul says, "And now, dear brothers and sisters, one final thing. Fix your thoughts on what is true and honorable and right and pure and lovely and admirable." Paul's saying, look for the good. Think about things that are excellent and worthy of praise. The second one is this: who do you listen to? When the spies came back, 2 gave a positive report, 10 gave a negative. Hundreds of thousands of people heard both reports, and they had to decide who to listen to, and they listened to the negative voice. They listened to the 10. We have an overwhelming number of negative voices vying for our attention today. I don't know of any time in history to compare. We have more access to negative and contrary voices than at any other time. Reporting has gone away. Now it's just all analysis, right? And it's the prevalent form, and every voice is saying why 40% of the nation is stupid and terrible. And it's coming from everywhere. According to what we hear all the time, we're either really smart or really stupid. Depends on who you're talking to. Don't think that doesn't shape your perspective when those are the voices you're hearing, especially if you're listening. Who are you listening to? Even in our own heads, there's negative voices. How many of those exist compared to positive ones? Maybe that's just me, and maybe I shouldn't have admitted I heard voices telling me things. But I used to be terrified on Sunday morning. I listened to the voice that said I wasn't good enough, prepared enough, worthwhile enough. I listened to the voice that said no one cared, or that I couldn't do it. It took a long time to start to listen to the other voice, the quiet, positive one that said, with God, I am enough, that I need to stop listening to fear. What are we listening to? Are you feeling overwhelmed by negative messaging? You know, a great way to overcome that, by the way, is worship music. You focus on singing about and listening to what God has done. In fact, when we finish today, we're going to finish by singing Waymaker. Okay? We're going to sing about the fact that God is the way maker. He's the miracle worker. He's the overcomer. He's the doer. Right? You listen to worship music that's going to drown out negative voices, going to help shift your perspective. And the last one is this: what kind of words are you speaking? 10 men give a negative report, and the people complain, and they blame, and they criticize, and they call for a new leader. They say God is against them. Moses and Aaron are to blame for following him, and their words give life to the reports, and what they say brings life to fear. Proverbs chapter 18, it says, the tongue can bring death or life. Our words create worlds. The reports from the 10 were negative, but then they grew, and they added to their assessment, and suddenly the land devoured those who dwelled there, and suddenly they looked like grasshoppers, and they're easily crushed. If you're using words of fear, eventually you're going to see yourself as the grasshopper. If you're constantly speaking words of anger or condemnation or hurt, it's going to change how you see the world. You know, I'm sure Joshua and Caleb had a certain amount of fear when they saw this. They had to have. They saw giants. But their perspective was shaped by their trust in God. They were looking for the good. They were hearing his voice, and their words were the words of hope. And so what they said, instead of we'll never get through, they said, we can do this. God is with us. He is our strength. I won't be overwhelmed because God's on my side. The task seems impossible, but God called me to it, so he's going to make it possible. I don't know what you're looking for today. I don't know what you're hearing or what words you're speaking, but I want to encourage you with this. God is leading you out of the desert. And it may seem like the opposition is overwhelming, but guess what? Taking the land isn't on your shoulders. God's just leading you into it. He's going ahead of you and he's working for you because you aren't enough on your own. But in Mark chapter 10, Jesus says, with man this is impossible. But guess what? Let's read this together. With man this is impossible, but not with God. All things are possible with God. I don't know what you're looking for. I don't know what you're hearing. I don't know what you're speaking. But I'll tell you right now, all things are possible with God. If you let Him be the one who is guiding you and leading you and giving you strength, the opposition isn't overwhelming. And all of a sudden, your voice ceases to be one of the 10, it becomes one of the 2. Now, I know this doesn't help you change that shoe from gray and green to pink and white. It didn't help me either, but I get the idea. We need a shift in our perspective, but we have to let God do that. Okay? Let's pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, I just give you thanks for how you can help us shift our lives if we're open to it. So, Lord, I pray this morning for each and every person in here, Lord, help us to be grateful for what you're doing. Help us to look for the opportunities you're placing before us. Lord, help us to shift our perspective. Can we see things, Lord, with eyes that look through you rather than eyes that just see fear and overwhelming opposition? Lord, shift our perspectives today. Make us more grateful and optimistic people in the week ahead. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.